So my topic here today is the role of Yama and Niyama to attain Atyantika Dukkha Nivritti. And while one progressively moves towards attaining this Atyantika Dukkha Nivritti, he or she will also came to know about, or he will experience this mindfulness state also. And mindfulness has various definitions in the narrow sense and the broader sense. So to explain it as I understood, I will start with a story. In 16th century Kerala, it started actually in 15th century and it lasted up to 18th century. There was a branch of mathematics known as Kerala School of Mathematics. So many new developments, especially in the field of calculus and astronomical mathematics, originated in that period. Originally, it was started by Madhava of Sangamagrama. So there was one famous astronomer. He's also a poet. I will come to his poetic ability later in that lineage. So one day morning, he was staying in his ancestral house while after bath, he was moving through the prayer hall, towards the prayer hall. So the grandfather was an astrologer and he was preparing for the daily Prasna. Prasna means in Kerala astrological tradition, every day morning they will calculate the Panchanga for that day and they will keep the kavadi, the shells in particular order. The Navagrahas and all other points will be kept in that particular wooden platform. So unfortunately, this young boy stumbled upon this thing and all the particular arrangements which he has done for that particular day was removed, and then he was in a very difficult situation. So the grandfather became very angry and shouted at this boy, "Hey, why you did? I have spent several hours to calculate this and I set all this for today's Panchanga, but in 1 second you have destroyed." Then young boy told, "Oh, sir, grandfather, I will help you. So give me 1 minute." And he just took 1 minute to reset it in its entire original form. So what happened was, while he was going, he just had a glance over the Prasna Palaga or that particular wooden table. And within that glance, he could identify what was the original location, what was the position. And that was kept in his memory, just like a CCTV camera or a video camera is capturing us. So that can be, and then he could reproduce the entire in its original form. So the young boy was none other than Melpathur Narayana Bhattadiri, the author of Narayaniyam also. So this is one example of mindfulness. Means whatever activity we are doing, it's not a kind of full focus and as we encounter in meditation, but whatever we do, in full focus, a kind of infinite focus everywhere. It need not be limited to this room, but in its expansive stage, even if the event happens outside the room, we'll have its relation with that. So with that small story, we'll start Yama Niyama. So come whatever stream, there are different streams of yoga and all this Advaitic Vedic text, but one of the fundamental requirement to excel in the sadhaka life, the path of yogi, is practicing of Yama and Niyama. And a brief introduction, and a deep introduction actually, of Yoga Sutras are already given by my previous speakers. So I will not venture into the components of Yoga Sutras, but as sir mentioned, there are four chapters. It starts with Samadhi, and then Sadhana, and then Vibhuti, and then Kaivalya. So the second chapter discusses various techniques which one should follow. What are the things we have to practice? And he lists, actually there are three levels, because for the higher level, Patanjali Maharshi gives one set of practices. For the middle or the intermediate practitioner, he gives another set of techniques. And for the beginner level, for most of the people, he gives Ashtanga Yoga. So it starts with Yama, Niyama, Asana, Pranayama, Pratyahara, then Dharana, Dhyana, and Samadhi. So among this, the Yama and Niyama are the first or the fundamental steps. Without Yama and Niyama, we cannot practice anything. We can practice, but the perfection will not be attained. And also, at a later stage, he gives what is Yama? I think. Should I deal? We have time now. Okay. So Yama, there are five components: Ahimsa, Satyam, Asteyam, Brahmacharyam, and Aparigraham. And then we have Niyamas, Shaucham, Santosham, Tapas, Ishwara Pranidhanam, and then Swadhyayam. So Yama are more like the thing which he has to do mentally, and the other then and it interacts in his interactions with society also, because ahimsa, then brahmacharyam, all this kind of thing. So we all know, at least from a general level, we know what are the five components of Yama and five components of Niyama. But immediately after announcing Yama, I think in 2.32, the universal nature, because you have to follow irrespective of whether you are your gender, your caste, jati. He uses the word jati. I don't know whether it has the correspondent modern notion. So irrespective of jati, kalam, desham, and the occasion, samaya. So irrespective of whether you are a king or a soldier or a priest, if you want to practice and attain kaivalya, you have to practice absolute ahimsa. There is no division, or there is no concession for being a soldier. You can do this ahimsa. No, at least that is what I understood after reading Hariharanda Swamiji's commentary. So the modern commentators give their own other versions, like a soldier as part of his dharma can do some kind of ahimsa. But the original, the intention of Patanjali Maharshi is irrespective of jati and kala and desha and the occasion in life, samaya, you have to practice ahimsa, satyam, asteyam, brahmacharyam, and aparigraha. So these are the five yamas, and after that the other five niyamas are also there. And so this, after defining yama, niyama, and then he starts defining each of the benefits. So what's the benefit of practicing ahimsa? So the list is around 5 plus 5, so 5 plus 6 actually, 5 benefits of Yama and then 6 benefits. He gives the purity, there are 2 benefits, the Shaucha, internal benefit and external benefit. So after summarizing all the benefits, he says, unless you practice this, there will be some difficulties. For example, if we want to practice ahimsa, but we will encounter some situation where we have to practice ahimsa. At least in our mind, we will think, oh, I want to kill that person, I want to revenge that act, I want to hit him, or at least in the mental level. So he gives a technique. Immediately, you have to remove this by using the technique Pratipaksha Bhavana. So that's one important technique, an important sutra. So maybe I think all in the entire 196 sutra, for a common man, for a maybe from a student perspective, the most important is Pratipaksha Bhavana. So whenever a negative thoughts comes, imagine the opposite, the effect of it. For example, if I hit that person, or if I take somebody from him, or if I did not practice Brahmacharya in this particular occasion, what will be the consequences? So we have to think about it, and based on that thinking, we have to correct ourselves. So that is has been detailedly discussed in the paper also. And then this Yama and Niyama are not only limited to Patanjali's Yoga Sutra. For example, Swami Veda Bharati has listed more than 100 texts which deals with different types of Yama and Niyama. Some list only one Yama, that is Ahimsa, which is the universal Yama, and some list as long as 16 Yamas. I think Manasolasa, the text list around 15 to 16 Yamas also, and Niyamas. So that is about the universality, and this is from the second chapter. In the third chapter, Patanjali Maharshi describes the benefits of practicing the last three, Dharana, Dhyanam, and Samadhi. So this together he is calling it a Samyama. So Samyama on this particular object or particular being will give you some benefits. So all these are considered as supernatural abilities. Some of the abilities are, we can fly, we'll have the universal knowledge, we'll have the power of an elephant, we'll have all this kind of different beautiful experiences. Then at 337, he gives, oh, but all these are hindrances towards your ultimate goal. So even though it is good in materialistic world. So about the mindfulness, I will come at the next sutra. So all this comes, all these qualities, all these supernatural powers, whatever you are acquiring, will be good only in the materialistic world. But if you want to excel, but if you want to achieve your final goal of kaivalya, you have to discard it and go beyond it. And so he gives tadvairagyatavi, even that you have to discard so that you will attain kaivalyam in 350. third chapter, 50th sutra. And he progresses, and at one stage he says, I think already the seven stages of a sadhaka, his mental, has been already discussed in the first paper itself. At one stage, it is in 3.51, the 51st sutra, he gives a vani. Because at the highest level of sadhaka, we will level of practice, one will become omniscience. He will be almost identical to Ishvara. Sarvajnatam, that is the knowledge he will gain. So that stage, he will have an invitation from Stani Pramanis, means the gods, demigods, or the devadas of that particular world. And they will invite us, they will offer us Amrutatva, Kamadeno, beautiful women. I don't know why they have mentioned woman. Maybe at that time he considered the practitioner is only a man. So all this kind of offer. So immediately the commentator says, wait, you have to do Pratipaksha Bhavana here. The Hariharanda says, just imagine a dog is eating its own vomit. So do you want to like that? You have discarded everything and you have reached at this final stage just before attaining Kaivalya. Again, these people are inviting and offering you many luxurious things and Amrita extra. Do you want it? Do you want to eat your own vomit as a dog does? No. So do Pratipaksha Bhavana and then go back and then discard it and then practice higher things. So this is the second announcement of this warning. First he announced it in 2.33 also, that Pratipaksha Bhavana, we have to do all this Pratipaksha Bhavana or the opposite thinking to escape from the practice of to practice Yama and Niyama. And at a later stage, this 3.52, he again wants us, even he is not using the term Pratipaksha Bhavana, but he gives this example. The commentator gives this example, just like a this dog eats its own vomit. We should not do that. We should think about it and we should discard it. Okay. So between this, there is a kind of sandwich. The two warnings are, and all the benefits are sandwiched between these two Pratipaksha Bhavana warnings. And the immediate next sutra, he says, Kshana and its Krama. Samyama on Kshana Kramayoho. Means you have to focus on the instantaneous moment and its Krama, its sequence. Then you will attain Sarvajnata. So this can be considered as the instantaneous living or living in presence. So here two commentators like Vajaspati Misra. Vajaspati Misra says this is an expansion of 3.49, where 3.49 offers an ultimate sadhaka life, that is equivalent to the Sarvajnatam. So how you will get Sarvajnatam? The instantaneous focus. The instantaneous moment, focus on it, then you will get the ultimate focus. So this can be considered, the mindfulness as per this can be considered as a vibhuti only. To attain the final stage, the Kevala Purusha, you have to go even beyond it and at least reach the final stage. That is my conclusion. So the idea is, since the beginning of description of benefits and the conclusion of description of benefit, he has mentioned the necessity of practicing Yama and Niyama. Every practitioner, irrespective of whether he is a mundane practitioner to excel in his management skills or somebody who wants to excel in his, to want to achieve Kaivalya, should practice Yama Niyama in it perfect. Otherwise, we'll have several examples in our day-to-day life where yoga acharyas are arrested for rape and all the other things. I conclude here. Thank you. Namaste.